Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Finding My Place, written and read by Anne Aly. Dedication. This one's for David John Allen. Till the end. Preface. I have never been one of those people with a head full of stories. I'm in awe of those who are, of the George Martins, Umberto Ecos and J.K. Rowlings of this world, with an unfathomable ability to weave words into fantastic tales of imaginary worlds, of dungeons and dragons, wizards and witches and shit like that. Even as a child, my mind was more consumed with questions about this world. Questions like, what if I'd been born in a different place and different time? Would I still be me or some other version of me? What if my parents had gone to the United States instead of Australia, as they had originally planned? I guess you could say I'm more into meanings than dreamings. I've grown fond of other people's stories, though. Listening to their stories has helped me connect with them, see the world through their eyes, and contextualise my own life experiences. I've had the opportunity to meet some pretty impressive people in my life, famous people, influential people, and some very important ones. I've met world leaders, ambassadors, heads of big government departments, policymakers, business people, and even a couple of monarchs. But the most inspirational people I've met have never been on the cover of a magazine. They've never spoken at conferences or written opinion pieces for the New York Times. They haven't been on Oprah, and they don't have 2 million followers on Instagram. People like the mother doing it tough with 5 kids on a single income. People like the teenager looking after his drug-addicted mother and his little sister while managing to get himself to school every day. People like the young refugee whose family fled civil war in Somalia and who went on to meet the Queen of England. Most ordinary people have extraordinary stories to tell. Stories of love, of loss, of grief, or joy. Stories hidden deep beneath the mundane and away from the everyday. Stories that sit like crumbs on an empty plate waiting patiently to be scooped up by a hungry child. And yet, in comparison, I don't see my own life's journey as particularly extraordinary, though I'm often told that it is. My life to date has not been defined by substantial loss or grief. I haven't mourned too many loved ones, and I've not experienced the pain of loss that I see etched on the faces of those who have. My face does not bear the scars of a difficult life. That could be just good genetics or interventions of a different kind. I'd like to say it's healthy living and that I drink 3 litres of water a day, practice daily yoga, and have a fastidious skincare regime that consists of weekly therapies with organic avocado and grape skin concoctions made up in my very own kitchen. Truth is, I do none of those things. I was born Azza, Mahmoud, Fawzi, Hosseini, Ali, Serougi. Yes, I know it's a mouthful. When my parents came to Australia, there just wasn't enough space on the form for a 5-word family name. So I became Azza Ali, Ali with a Y being the anglicised version of Ali with an I. From the age of 10, I've been known as Anne Aly. And this is my story. Prologue. From my designated seat in the House of Representatives chamber, I watch the pomp and ceremony that presides over the official opening of Parliament with wide-eyed bemusement. We don't do pomp in my house. If I really want to impress someone, I set the table. At last, my name was called. I had to will my legs to stop shaking as I made my way to the dispatch box to take my place alongside 10 others waiting to be sworn into the 45th Parliament of Australia. The dispatch box, originally used to transport documents to the chamber, rests on a grand wooden table adorned in worn green leather. The table sits in the middle of the House of Representatives chamber, separating the government and opposition. At one end, closest to the Speaker's podium, sit the clerks, clothed in ceremonial black robes. At the other, an ornate gold staff called the mace rests on brackets. The mace, originally a weapon of war, symbolises the authority of the House. I was about to become the first ever Muslim woman elected to the Australian Federal Parliament, the first Muslim woman MP. It wasn't something I'd set out to do. It wasn't like I had become first Muslim woman MP written on my bucket list between break the world record for number of Zoolander viewings and get a job as one of those people who taste new flavours of ice cream for a living. Throughout the election campaign, it had been raised with me once or twice, but I'd shrugged it off each time with a nonchalant meh. I wasn't interested in being the first anything. First Muslim, first Arab, first Egyptian-born, first African, first graduate of Edith Cowan University, first expert in the art of homeless-making. It didn't matter to me if I was the first, or second, or 35th. I never wanted to make history. I just wanted to make a difference. For me, my election meant a win for my party and for my electorate. But there were those for whom my win carried more meaning than I could ever have imagined. So while I might try to play down the significance of it all, I couldn't ignore it. Every journalist who interviewed me wanted to know the same thing. How does it feel to be the first Muslim woman in Parliament? It's a funny question, really. I suspect it didn't feel any different for me than it did for any of the other 149 people who'd been elected. I responded to these questions with something about it being good to have a diverse parliament and looking forward to taking part in some robust debates. But the truth was, I really didn't know how I was supposed to feel about it at all, if indeed I actually felt anything about it at all. The days immediately following my election win are a bit of a blur, but there are the occasional moments that stand out in my memory. It's like driving through a torrential downpour with the windscreen wipers going full bore and not being able to make out anything more than obscure shapes and sounds amid the white noise. And then suddenly, without warning, you reach a moment, a few seconds or half a minute or so of clarity, when the windscreen wipers part and you recognise where you are and where you're heading, and you breathe a sigh of relief because you know you didn't miss the turnoff. One such moment was a pre-recorded interview with SBS Arabic Broadcast. I'd just finished and was off the record when the interviewer said, "It's so great to have you in Parliament. You know, I tell my daughter every day that she can be whatever she wants to be. But you've made it real." It was the first time I actually thought about just how significant my first was. If not in my own mind, then for young girls who, like my 12-year-old self, were searching for some kind of validity in a place that often made them feel less than valid. Perhaps, after all, I was still searching for that validity and for my place. Chapter 1. Child of the Naksa. Egypt, 1967. The blaring summer heat. Evening walks along the Corniche and Nil. Ice-cold carob juice from the street vendor. The songs invoking a greater Arab homeland. Mohammed Hassanen Haikal's weekly column, frankly, in the Akhbar al-Yom, or Daily News. The cries from women in their house dresses greeting the familiar clang of the gas bottle man. The taxi fare starting at a meagre 6 piastres. The Friday matinee at the Cinema Metro. The voice of the Arabs radio. Abdul Halim Hafiz, the Muslim Brotherhood, Gamal Abdel Nasser and Arab nationalism. The fading promise of a better Egypt. If the 1960s symbolised the era of making love, not war, of blowing in the wind, the Beatles, liberation and hope, it was not the world that greeted my arrival. I was born in a period when war and conflict marked time, in a country when the birth of a girl child, especially a second girl child, was greeted not with ululation, cigars and approving nods, but the clicking of tongues and commiserations. On Monday, 5th of June 1967, I was just 10 weeks old. It was a day when humiliation replaced pride, defeat and disillusion replaced hope, mourning replaced celebration. The labour pains of war birthed a new Egypt, where the symbols of the future, Arabism, the power of the people and national liberation, were suddenly relegated to a bygone era, the hollow ruminations of old men sipping dark coffee and oversugared black tea in alfresco cafes. The Israeli forces, led by none other than Ariel Sharon, had launched a preemptive attack on the Egyptian Air Force stationed on the Sinai Peninsula. The forces had been there since May as the nation became engulfed in the swell of anticipation. Victory was inevitable, or so they thought. Egypt would prove its might and, with the united Arab force, reclaim the Sinai. 100,000 troops had been mobilised to the region. Israel's show of force, consisting of 700 tanks and 70,000 troops, paled in comparison. But the Israelis had taken them by surprise. The plan was well coordinated, precisely formulated, and immaculately executed. It was anticipated that the battle would be fought at Abu Aghila, a strategic access point in the north of the Sinai Peninsula, close to the Israeli border, and only 45 kilometres southeast of El Arish. Instead, the Israelis launched an offensive at the Omakatif Plateau to the east and mobilised two brigades from the north of Omakatif. The first broke through the defences, and the second blocked the road to El Arish. Israeli paratroopers rained destruction on Egypt's artillery, preventing it from engaging. Combined forces then attacked the Egyptian troops on all fronts, effectively ambushing them. Word was that the Egyptian Minister of Defence, Abdel Hakim Amer, panicked and ordered all units in Sinai to retreat. The pride of the Egyptian people, the largest and most heavily equipped Arab army, had been defeated. Egypt had yielded, broken and humiliated. The screams of the Sinai, now littered with the empty shells of tanks and ashen remains of burning vehicles, resonated through the heart of Egypt. The Naksa, literally the setback as it came to be known, marked more than just the disheartening defeat of the United Arab Armies. It marked an entire generation, like a giant birthmark smack bang in the middle of our foreheads. I first heard the term child of the Naksa the year I turned 40. On 28th of July 2007, Mona El Tahawi, an Egyptian-born international journalist with whom I had worked, wrote in the Washington Post, "My birth at the end of July 1967 makes me a child of the Naksa. We children of the Naksa were born not only on the cusp of loss, but also of the kind of disillusionment that whets the appetite of religious zealots." Somehow, reading about the circumstances of my birth put everything into context for me. Though my parents left Egypt in 1969, the significance of the setback felt so familiar to me. I had always felt that my life was eclipsed by an indelible stain that I couldn't quite put my finger on. I've always felt like I was never quite good enough, a setback. And I've spent much of my life striving to prove that I am good enough, most of the time to the wrong people. My parents were part of Egypt's massive working class. They were not the elite who holidayed in Europe and sent their children to be educated in private boarding schools in the United Kingdom or the United States. They weren't the uneducated poor masses either, who lined up for weekly rations of sugar and flour at the public co-op. They were mediocre, much like the tens of millions of middle-class, educated and practically poor of Egypt. They lived on modest incomes, in modest homes, and exuded middle-class morality. And yet, despite the circumstances of my birth, at least in my public life, I've managed to rise above the Naksa. I have enjoyed opportunities that many people would consider extraordinary. An extensive education, travel, an international reputation as a researcher and practitioner in countering terrorism and radicalisation, and a political career. Though I and those close to me know my struggles, to others, it often feels like the most extraordinary thing about any of my achievements is that I managed to pull it all off while being female, brown, and Muslim. As if somehow this particular combination presents an insurmountable challenge, the enormity of which can only be explained by some kind of extraordinariness on my part, or by the extraordinary freedoms imparted to me by the society I grew up in. There is a sense that what belies the marvel of how did she do it is an inherent belief that, had I been female, brown, and Muslim in some other part of the world, I most definitely couldn't have done it. Maybe there is some truth in that. I'll leave that to you to decide. I've never looked at my life through a rearview mirror that reflects only gender, colour or religion. In fact, it's safe to say that I rarely look at my life through the rearview mirror at all. Occasionally, I'll look back to see the path I've come down, but only occasionally. Some people manage to cruise through life like a scenic drive through the countryside. Others find themselves stuck in peak hour traffic. Others still travel down the highway of life at maximum speed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.